In those days, the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jephthah, and he passed through Gilead and Manasseh, and passed on to Mizpah of Gilead. And from Mizpah of Gilead he passed on to the Ammonites. And Jephthah made a vow to the Lord and said, "If you will give the Ammonites into my hands, then you never come forth from the doors of my house to meet me when I return victorious from the Ammonites, shall be the Lord's, and I will offer him up for a burnt offering." So Jephthah crossed over to the Ammonites to fight against them, and the Lord gave them into his hands. And he struck them from Aroer to the neighborhood of Milim, 20 cities, and as far as Engel Caramel, with a very great slaughter. So the Ammonites were subdued before the sons of Israel. Then Jephthah came to his home at Mizpah, and behold, his daughter came out to meet him, with timbers and with dances. She was his only child. Besides her, he had neither son nor daughter. And when he saw her, he told his clothes and said, "Alas, my daughter, you have brought me very low, and you have become the cause of great trouble to me. Why, I have opened my mouth to the Lord, and I cannot take it." And she said to him, "My father, if you have opened your mouth to the Lord to do to me according to what has gone forth from your mouth, now that the Lord has avenged you on your enemies, on the Ammonites." And she said to her father, "Let this thing be done for me. Let me alone 2 months, that I may go and wander on the mountains and be weighed by the divinity, I and my companions." And he said, "Go." And he sent her away for 2 months. And she departed, she and her companions, and we weighed the divinity upon the mountains. And at the end of 2 months, she returned to her father, who did with her according to his vow, which he had made. The way of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Her response to the psalm, "See, I have come, Lord, to do your will."
"See, I have come, Lord, to do your will."
Bless the man who has placed his trust in the Lord, and has not gone over to the proud who follow false gods.
"See, I have come, Lord, to do your will."
You delight not in sacrifice and offerings, but in an open ear. You do not ask for holocausts and victims. Then I said, "See, I have come."
"See, I have come, Lord, to do your will."
In the scroll of the book, it stands written of me, "I delight to do your will, O my God, where instruction lies deep within me." Your justice I have proclaimed in the great assembly. My lips I have not said, you know it, O Lord.
See, I have come, Lord, to do your will.
Thank you.
Jesus spoke to the chief priests and the elders of the people in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to the king who gave a marriage feast for his son, and sent his servants to call those who were invited to the marriage feast, but they would not come. Again he sent other servants, saying, 'Tell those who are invited, behold, I have made ready my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves are killed, and everything is ready. Come to the marriage feast.' But they made light of it and went off, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his servants, treated them shamefully, and killed them. The king was angry, and he sent his troops and destroyed those villages and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore to the streets and invite to the marriage feast as many as you find.' Those servants went out into the streets and gathered all that they found, both bad and good. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to look at the guests, he saw their man had no wedding garments. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind them hand and foot and cast them into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.'" The Gospel of the Lord. Reform in the church has probably been sought by every generation. Just as individuals constantly need to go back to the gospel and renew their relationship with the truth of Christ, so the church needs to constantly renew itself in the gospel of Christ. Some areas have a more insistent need for reform than others do. The church in the 1600s needed reform. One of those who led the way was St. John Eudes. John Eudes was born in France in the year 1601. He was a lad at the age of 24 and began to experience great success as a teacher. A good part of his life was the preaching of missions. Short but intense parish retreats in parishes throughout France as a home missionary. It is said that in his lifetime he preached over 100 missions. John Eudes did not call for structural reform in the church as such. His emphasis was on conversion of hearts. This effort to bring people closer to the Lord is the real center of any reform. Without a change of heart, structural reform simply rearranges the chairs. A change of heart can bring new life even to an old way of doing things. His emphasis on parish missions was one element of his efforts at reform. Another was the training of clergy. He organized the Guild of Priests, later known as the Congregation of Jesus and Mary, and today as the Eudists, to teach in seminaries and form future priests in the love of Jesus Christ. Popular morality being at an end, there were many unmarried and abandoned women who were pregnant. He established a congregation of sisters to care for them with dignity, help them bring their pregnancy to term, and enable them to lead a new life. And I'm so grateful for Mercy Haven, our parish here in Boxford, which looks after abused women and children with similar needs. John Eudes also founded a society for widows, which had formed what we would call a secular institute. In addition to preaching, starting seminaries, and caring for widows and unwed mothers, he preached devotion to the Sacred Heart of Jesus and also to the Immaculate Heart of Mary. Through this devotion, he wanted people to appreciate the great love God has for them and their true worth which that love shows. He wanted people to experience, as St. Paul tells the Ephesians, the full breadth and length of Christ's love for them and the appreciation that Christ works and ministers through them. His love is an energy that empowers the Christian to do the work of Jesus. There are always many suggestions for reform on the table. The deepest source of church renewal will always be in the truth and love of Jesus Christ. When Jesus touches the heart, true reform of the church and our life begins. As the Lord calls us to the banquet of the Eucharist, let us speed Him in prayer. We pray for the Church that it may so speed and act through us that the world will respond to God's call. Lord, hear us. For the government and other secular authorities, that the concerns of this world may not blind them to the concerns of God. Lord, hear us. For the vision to understand that, no matter how important worldly affairs may appear, all that really matters is to be one with God in the heavenly banquet. For the gift of charity, which is the true wedding garment. Lord, hear us. For the conversion of our stony hearts, that they may be ready to love and do God's will. Lord, hear us. Father, you love us with the love
which is beyond all we could ever look for or imagine. You are attentive to every need before every other of ourselves. Look upon us, your children, and look kindly upon us as we call upon you in the name of Jesus Christ. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness to the seed bred among you, fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness to the seed lie among you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual food.
You are indeed holy, O Lord. the fount of all holiness. May the Holy Temple be said to be present by sending down the Spirit of God and like the people, so that they can become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and giving thanks broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
Peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy
we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on our faithful Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you all. Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Thank you.
let us pray. May our Saviour at the heavenly table of Almighty God confirm the peace strength of our heart in order to celebrate the feast day of Blessed St. John Eudes, that we may preserve the integrity, the gift of faith, and walk the path of salvation he traced for us through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord. Saint Michael the Archangel, defend us in the hour of battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke you, we humbly pray, and do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, thrust down into hell Satan and all the evil spirits who wander through the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen. Let us please sing hymn number 606.